wanted to do something about Miami's history because there's a lot of crime that happened here and no one's ever really done anything about it. And I said, well, I've researched all that stuff and I've got an idea for this story about like the history of Miami through the eyes of one Latin American family for like 100 years of the history, just jumping every couple seasons, like 100 years of solitude was really the influence.
Yes.
And I started just saying like, you know, like Miami Beach was the most racist part of the country when it started. You couldn't even be a minority after sundown. You had to go back to the mainland. You had to have an ID. And it started like that, like Flagler and Collins and Fisher, the guys who really kind of built this city out of nothing to make money, that's how they were. And the reason Miami became a big city is because they told everyone during Prohibition, when drinking alcohol was illegal, you can come to Miami, party, get drunk, and we won't arrest you. And that's how Miami became Miami.
Wow.
So it's really wild to now look at Miami and see how diverse it's become, although it still has all of its undercurrents. It fascinated me. So he was like, all right, you're hired. And that was our phone call. And so I got the job to write this pilot for a TV series for James Franco to direct and produce. And I had to write it really fast. So I think I wrote it in 3 months, designed the whole series, and with like all the episodes for the first season and how it would turn into the second season and then where the show would go for the next 5 years. So pretty much like 50 hours of story figured out before anything was actually done. And he sent it to HBO. And HBO considered it and almost bought it. And 6 months later said, no, we're not gonna do it. And it was like 6 months on edge. So he called and he said, I think they're idiots for not doing it. But if you wanna write something and set it in LA and do a similar tone, I think we can get it made. So I jumped and wrote that one and ended up having less time. So I wrote that like in 2 months. And to my surprise, we started moving forward. So we cast it and we shot it and we directed it basically and we had a pilot. And then everyone was really proud of it, but we ran out of money in post-production, which is when you're editing and when you're fixing the color, which is kind of like if you Instagram, you know how the picture is not that great when you first take it and you put the filter and it's suddenly marvelous. So every movie, everything you see, that's how it looks. And that cost a lot of money. Yeah. So we were out of money and Disney, which had bought Maker Studios, Disney said Maker's gonna do different stuff now, so we don't have any room for TV shows like this, which was like a crime saga. So you guys can do whatever you want with what you have, this unfinished thing, but we're not giving you any more money. So that's why it's never come out.
Wow.
So this is really like the roller coaster of being a writer in LA. And I'm one of the lucky ones. Like I feel blessed to even have gotten that far because most of my friends who are good writers have never had anything. So when we were on set for LA Series, which is the show we shot, James said, he asked me if I'd heard of a band called Guns N' Roses. You guys?
Yeah.
Yes.
So I was like, yeah, I grew up listening to them. I'm that old now. And he said, well, we got the rights to this book, and we are looking to do a movie about it. Will you read the book and tell us what you think? And I read the book and got back to him a few days later and came up with an idea for how to tell the story, and then got hired to write a movie about the early days of Guns N' Roses for him. So then that basically got me over to the Sony thing, where just someone on a fluke read it and called me in for a meeting and said, we like your script. We can't make it because it's too dark for what Sony does. You know, they do kind of Spider-Man and bigger tentpole movies, they call them, like $100 million budget movies. And they wanted to do something that would be half here and half in China. And I'd been to China a few years ago. So I came up with an idea for that and they hired me to write that. And so now that's in the Sony pipeline. And, you know, it's a lot of kind of these ups and downs. And this is like the Cliff Notes version. This doesn't take in like all the like really big disappointments and all the times where it seemed like you might as well give up now, which you guys will get a little bit more familiar with as you're like out there, putting yourselves out there. But that's basically been the ride. So now I'm still at it, working on a project. 360 are the ones that do Game of Thrones. And we're developing a couple series. And we'll see how that goes. One of them is the story about my dad and my family that I've always wanted to tell. So it's kind of come full circle. And another one's actually about Ichai. So it really all cycles through. So yeah, so that's like a kind of dense take on everything so far. There's probably a lot of stuff I've left out, but what I really would like to do, if you guys are interested, is answer any questions that you have and just kind of talk about this stuff.
Why don't you try to write something about the game that happened in Southeast?
That's a great question. So that's when I was in D-Tai, basically when I was in Mr. D's class, that's all I wanted to do. Yeah. And that's one of the projects that I'm now developing. I still had all the stuff from back then. I kept all the writing. And the problem was I would never settle on anything. So I'd write like 50 pages, but it's not good enough. And I'd start again. And I never finished. The whole time I was at Beach, the furthest I got was 54 pages. But now I find I might have like all these different versions of the same story. Now I feel like I'm ready to do it. For a lot of time, it was not an idea that anyone was interested in because it was in the 90s. And for stuff that happened in the past to become kind of marketable, it usually needs like 20 to 30 years for the people that lived during that time to start to want to look back. And so that's why you see like all the 80s stuff now. And so it just kind of moves. And a few years ago, there was all the 70s stuff. And before then, it was 60s stuff. So it really happens every generation. But that is one of my babies. That's one of the main projects that I want to do. That's a good question. Yeah, I ask myself that all the time.
You ever got paid for the movie you did?
The
Argentina one?
No. That one, they never paid me. And then a couple years later, I found out he made a second one. So he made two movies. He took my name off of them. And I didn't get basically anything. The first one, it looked like it was moving forward. So they sent me like $500, which is nothing. And then that was all I ever got for the two that I wrote for them. But then it kind of comes back around, so then the Sony thing was much better.
Did you ever talk to your partner ever again?
Never again. Oh, thank you. Never again. And the weird thing, though, is his dream project was to write a Guns N' Roses movie and work for Sony. So he's in Argentina, but it's just kind of looped around. I didn't even go out trying to get it, and then it just kind of dropped in my lap. So you really never know how this stuff comes back around. And I kept thinking before coming, what am I gonna tell you guys? What can I say that really matters? What would I even remember if I had been where you're sitting and someone had come in back then? I was like, what am I gonna say? And I think the two things that jumped out at me are, one, it is harder than you think out. And it is going to get harder, in part because it's not just you competing with people from here, it's you're competing with people from all over the world. And I can tell you from having been to China, they work those kids. They are all studying all the time, and they are into the same stuff that we're into. So if you like something, you're just not competing with the people in this classroom or in this school or in this state. It's everywhere. So that was a big wake-up call to me, is to get to LA and think, oh, all you have to do is be a good writer. I think I'm a good writer. I'm all right. I can do it. I know about movies. And then find out that there are millions of people there that are like me, that love this stuff as much as I do, that can talk about it to you like I can. And it puts things in perspective. So I can just tell you, you got to really hustle. You got to love it, and you got to work hard. And pick something that you want to do, because you're lucky to even have a chance to try to pursue it. I feel that way about what I've been able to do. So just be ready. When I get back to LA, however hard I think it's gonna be harder. It always happens. And it's not like a straight climb, I'm going up the ladder. It's kind of like you go up two, and then you go down, and then you go back up, and then you go down again. And you write something really good, your best, and then you write something horrible, your worst. And it's really just about getting back into it and finding the passion after you put your heart out there and it's been stomped on 5 to 10 to 20 times. So that really one, just I wouldn't have even understood when I said it, but I just wanted to make sure to tell you guys. You know, and the world's changing all the time. So, like, I came from the generation where we thought, you go to college and you work really hard, you will have at least a decent life. You will be able to have some kids, you have a couple cars, you'll have a nice house, you'll have a job you don't hate, and you'll retire when you're like 65 and you'll be all right. And that's not really the truth now, unless you're coming from a really rich family. You're probably gonna be working till you're older. If you're lucky, you'll be able to have kids and pay for daycare for them. And it's not easy. So just prepare yourselves. I know I don't wanna be like all doom and gloom, but I wish that I would have known more. I wish I would have paid more attention. I wish I would have tried harder when I was here, because I was okay. I was acing regular English, but I could have been an AP. You know, I could have applied to bigger film schools. I could have maybe tried NYU because that's where my dad had gone. But I didn't even apply to NYU. I applied to Miami-Dade and the Art Institute.